to our worship celebration today, and what a glorious day it is. A lot happening. So fall semester is kind of nice because we kind of ease into everything. Last week we started a little more, and now this week we start even more. So, of course, ongoing is the board meetings and church council and school board meeting today. But tomorrow, American Heritage Girls begin their fall. So, so they're going to be gathering here in the evening. So that's getting back on track. Thursday, Women of Life are starting their monthly study back up again. So that's a good thing, right?
Yeah.
Saturday, Stars and Stripes Workday. If you haven't taken a look at the prayer garden, it's just really making all kinds of progress, and it's looking great. So if you are free, 8:30 in the morning, and just add a little thing about Workday. We had a fantastic Workday yesterday. A lot of people showed up, and a lot of work was done. A lot of repairs were made. And probably the greatest thing is AHG got all reorganized. We were able to clear off shelves in the records building. And I thought, well, it'll take me a little while to fill them up. And within a half hour, AHG had filled them up already. So that's a good thing. Next Sunday school begins, 9:30, all ages.
Amen.
And worship at 10:30. And just a little thing about next Sunday's worship, it's also New Members Sunday. So there you are. That's all I'm going to say. We have a potluck following worship. And then Women of Life have their annual fundraiser bake sale. And there's a sign-up sheet in the back if you're wanting to bring something. Ladies, well, and guys, be sure to sign the clipboard in the back. Okay? We don't want to miss Tuesday. Tom's already standing, Jessica. You get to stand. Anniversary day. So I just want to draw your attention in the bulletin to the classes that are being offered, continuing basically. James is continuing for our youth. Friendship group, continuing. And the adult study in the Koinonia Center, continuing. So there you have it. We hope you'll all be in prayer about where you want to be learning and away we go. So, I was asked this morning by one of our young people where I was on September 11th. Yesterday I was working here. No, I was. But I've been thinking about it because September 11th, 2001 was a Tuesday. And we were in the process of beginning Berean Christian School. School's been in place for 20 years. And so we weren't in class yet. Classes didn't start until October. So we were painting and building offices, and I mean, we were just doing real work. And I'm getting ready to come out here, and the phone rings, and Pat Massengill said three words: turn forwards. Turn on the TV. And there it was. So, we're going to revisit a little bit. This is a video that was done in 2012, Michael W. Smith. How many of you know about Michael W. Smith? He's a Christian songwriter, artist, singer, great composer, singer. So he has done this song in honor of September 11th. So one of the things we're careful not to do at Berean, because it seems to be a popular thing anymore to rewrite history. And that's one thing we will never do at Berean Christian School. And one of our young second graders, when I was sharing on Thursday, said, "What's a terrorist?" So we had a little discussion. So people need to know, we need to always remember. How many of you have been here? How many of you know what that is? That's the second greatest memorial to 9/11 from our greatest ally, Israel. And the shape at the top is of a flag, and down in the base there, see kind of a window? And there on site, you can look into that window, and there's actual steel from Ground Zero. And all the way around, all the names for those who lost their lives on 9/11. It's just a wonderful memorial.
Aren't the names written in English and Hebrew?
English and Hebrew, yes. So, Psalm 62. Beginning in verse 6. He only is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold, I shall not be shaken. On God my salvation, my glory rests. The rock of my strength, my refuge, is in God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Let's stand together.
I had asked Karen, we have a really super cheerful song, I know, and I said, wow, after that video, that's going to be a little rough, but you know, thinking about it, our emotions, we do feel our feelings and they help guide and direct us in certain directions. But our logic and our faith needs to come from his word, that we can enter his gates, we can have thanksgiving in our heart in all situations. It says, in everything, not for everything, in everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. And so we are going to enter his gates with thanksgiving in our hearts. I'm thankful that nothing else bad happened yesterday. And God has his hand upon his people who are called according to his purpose. So let's just sing our hearts out. Let's defy Satan and his destruction and just praise the banner of our Lord and King Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's do it. Okay.
Thank you.
deeper and deeper into your presence, that we might receive fully from you. We love you, we worship you, we praise you, and we ask that you bless us. In Jesus' name. seated. And I invite you to turn in your Bibles to our Old Testament lesson from the book of Exodus.
Catching my breath here. These songs are very powerful. Our Old Testament lesson is written in Exodus, chapter 19, verses 1 through 7. Exodus 19, 1 through 7. In the third month, after the sons of Israel had gone out of the land of Egypt, on that very day they came into the wilderness of Sinai. When they set out from Rephidim, they came to the wilderness of Sinai and camped in the wilderness. And there Israel camped in front of the mountain. Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the sons of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now then, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be my own possession among all the peoples. For all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the sons of Israel." So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set before them all these words which the Lord had commanded him. Our New Testament lesson is written in Revelation, the second chapter, beginning with the 16th verse. Revelation 2, 16 through 17. "Therefore repent, or else I am coming to you quickly, and I will make war against them with the sword of my mouth. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, to him I will give some of the hidden manna, and I will give him a white stone and a new name written on the stone which no one knows but he who receives it. This is the word of the Lord."
Amen. Please stand for our gospel. Our gospel this morning is from the gospel according to Matthew, the 18th chapter. Matthew 18, beginning with verse 1, where we read in Jesus' name. "At that time the disciples came to Jesus and said, 'Who then is greatest in the kingdom of heaven?' And he called a child to himself and set him before them and said, 'Truly I say to you, unless you are converted and become like children, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever then humbles himself as this child, he is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoever receives one such child in my name receives me.'" You may be seated. I'll invite our ushers to come forward at this time to wait upon us for our clients. As you find the scriptures This is like angel wings. So we have a text this morning, somewhat loosely related, but it's introducing our new series. It's a new series for many of you. It's an old series. I think the last time I went through this series was, I think, 2009. But I've been requested every year for the last 2 years to redo this series. And now is the time. Isaiah 40, beginning in verse 28. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become weary or tired. His understanding is inscrutable. He gives strength to the weary. To him who lacks might, he increases power. Though youths grow weary and tired, and vigorous young men stumble badly, yet those who wait for the Lord will gain new strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not get tired. They will walk and not become weary. The phrase I'm about to share with you, was first introduced to that phrase when I worked with the Home Missions Department of the Church of the Lutheran Brethren. Harlan Helden, the director, had this cup. And in those days, Home Missions was new to the Church of the Lutheran Brethren. There really had never been any real concern about planting churches in America. The focus of the Lutheran Brethren had always been global, always worldwide. World missions, that was it, that was the focus. And in the 70s, they began to realize that as the world church had grown so overwhelmingly, maybe 40 times larger than the American church, that unless the Lutheran Brethren grew here in America, there would be less and less of a support base for that world mission thrust. So here was this dear man, a heart for home missions, planting churches, given this tremendous responsibility with a next to nothing budget. And I know in my spirit that Harlan Helden would pull out of his pocket, his own pocket, most of the time, so that he could get the job done. The money just wasn't enough. And I was fortunate. He pulled me alongside of him to work with him in this venture. And it was interesting to see the attitudes within the administration of the Lutheran Brethren. It's one thing to have a church organization, church structure, but when you get up into, this is a synodical structure now, and when you get up into that kind of a structure, it takes on a different tone. And world missions was considered the serious ones, the stable, the focused, the sane people. Oh, home missions? That's how people would respond. see, we in home missions were the dreamers, the venturesome ones, the crazies. We went where others feared to go. Oh, isn't that something from Star Trek or something? So Harlan had this cup, this coffee cup. And on one side of this cup was a cartoon of turkeys. And on the other side of the cup were these words. It's tough to soar with the eagles when you work with a bunch of turkeys. My friend Jamie Buckingham, I've shared through the years about him. He would tell a story about a family of eagles. And this family, the mother eagle was a Baptist. Father eagle was a Pentecostal. And they had this egg. Now, the mother eagle had 113 meetings a week. So she wasn't in the nest very much. The father eagle had been called to save the world, so he wasn't there much either. And the result was that this little egg had to hatch itself. Out popped this little eagle. And looking around, he discovered he was all by himself. He looked down over the edge of the nest. Way down from that nest in the tree. No one was there. He looked up at the blue sky above. No one was there either. And immediately, as young as he was, he realized he was in a tough place. And he had a decision to make. I have to do something, he said. If I stay here in a nest, I'm going to die because there's no one here to feed me. And if I jump out of the nest, I might die because it's a long way down to the ground. Oh, and the ground is hard. So he made a quality decision. He thought it would be better to jump than to stay. So he crawled up on the edge of the nest and tumbled over the edge down to the ground, many, many feet below. Kerplop.
That isn't splat.
And as he was lying there, he was kind of starting to shake himself a little bit, trying to get up, trying to see if he was all together, if anything was broken. And when he finally was able to get up, he realized that he had actually fallen in the midst of a group of turkeys who were just wandering through the woods. Now the turkeys got really excited about this. You see, they've been praying for a new convert. And here is one that just fell out of the sky. This. They didn't have to do a single thing. They were all excited. They had a little hallelujah meeting. They welcomed him into the turkey family. Because they were loving turkeys, they said they would take care of him. They would feed him. They would train him. And sure enough, they did just that. They trained him in how to become a turkey. He learned how to do all the turkey things. He learned to do that little thing that they do. Gobble, gobble, gobble. Gobble, gobble, gobble. Gobble, gobble, gobble. And he mastered that. And they would have a praise meeting, and all would get together, and they'd all go, gobble, gobble, gobble. He learned how to do that funny thing with his neck.
This is great.
He had to work on that a bit. He'd go home at night and practice. And he learned then how to scratch in the dirt. Scratch in the dirt for the acorns. He had become a prize convert. In fact, when the turkeys would go out on their street meetings, they would take this little guy along as an example. How it is possible to learn to do things the right way. And everyone was always impressed. One day, he wandered away from the turkeys. He was out in the woods, all by himself. And all of a sudden, he heard this voice. Who? He looked around. He didn't see anybody. Then he heard it again. Who? And looking up in the tree, he saw this big old owl. The owl was saying, who? What do you mean? Said the little eagle. Responded the owl. Who are you? Well, can't you see? I'm a turkey. The owl said, you better look beyond the acorns. Look up. Well, he had never really looked up before. He'd always gone gobble, 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 and scratch, scratch in the dirt. So he looked up, and high in the sky, he saw something he had never seen before. He saw an eagle. Wings spread, riding on thermals, not moving a muscle. And there was something within him that sparked in his heart, way down deep inside, and he felt the tingle go all the way out from his chest to the tips of his wings, and suddenly they just spread out. And he looked at them and said, what are these? The owl said, these are wings. Didn't know I had any. I always kept them just tucked back here. I was told it wasn't spiritual to let them out. He tucked them back in again. He said, good turkeys never do that. Try, said the owl. And then do this. And as the eagle moved his wings back out, followed the instructions of the owl and started moving them, suddenly he was airborne. Well, did return to those dumb turkeys. He wasn't a turkey. He was an eagle. He had been an eagle all along. Unfortunately, he just didn't know it. He'd never been trained. Nobody had ever come along to him to ask him that right question, who are you? You see, you will always be confused with every issue in life until you know who you are. Looking down keeps us focused on our inadequacies. We lack confidence. We don't feel worthy. We have trouble accepting ourselves. Moses thought he was a failure at the age of 80 because he had failed to free his people. He killed an Egyptian. And now, where was he? He was on the backside of the Midian desert tending sheep. And if that wasn't bad enough, they were even his own sheep. They belonged to his father-in-law. And it took Almighty God to get Moses' attention through a burning bush to convince Moses that his lack of confidence, his inability to be a powerful speaker, they were absolutely of no significance. Because God, from on high, would be doing the work. 800 years after Moses, a man by the name of Jeremiah, looking down at the ground, told God that he was so young he couldn't speak very well. And when the would-be prophet finally looked up, what did he see? He saw the Lord stretching out his hand, touching his mouth, saying, "Behold, I have put my words in your mouth." The Bible is full of people who thought they were inadequate, who reasoned that they simply could not do anything significant for the kingdom. The church is full of people who think they are inadequate, who reason that they simply could not do anything significant for the kingdom. You see, our limitations are the result of how we see ourselves instead of seeing who we are in the eyes of God. Our limitations are the result of how we see ourselves looking in the mirror instead of seeing who we really are in the eyes of God. There's a danger in the church, particularly in the Lutheran church, to look at our baptism, ultimately our confirmation, as a point of completion rather than a point of positioning. It's wrong to say, "I've been baptized and confirmed. That's all that's necessary." When we see that, when we say that, we're looking at spiritual significance through our own selfish eyes. Looking at our baptism through the eyes of God reminds us that He has called us to be His own. He's called us by name. He has placed us as children in His family. He has not only adopted us, He has made us joint heirs with the true heir of all creation, His only Son, our Lord Jesus. He has given us His power. Oh, oh, how we need to be reminded of who we are, or better yet, whose we are. When you stop scratching around in the dirt for acorns, when you stop keeping our wings tucked back, we need to look up. Look up and discover that we are eagles in the eyes of God. Thank you, Lord, for making us a part of your family. Lord, for helping us to understand who we are in your eyes. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I wasn't going to share anything right here, but as he was preaching, I had shared something up at youth camp, and I feel it's appropriate to share it here, talking about turkeys and all. I was one of those turkeys. I just didn't get with God's program as far as music. I took piano lessons as a little kid. Did great until she discovered I could read music for a darn. And so she quit playing the songs for me, and I quit being able to know how to play them because I couldn't hear them. And so, yeah, heck with that, I started playing guitar. Just kind of did my own thing through high school and through, you know, and I was always, believe it or not, I'm not an upfront kind of person. I don't, by nature, I don't like the attention, and I don't like being in the forefront. I'd be just as happy singing in the choir room with a speaker out here. I used to break out in hives. I just didn't, you know, this was not my personality. And many years ago, I was at a church service. They had an evangelist come in. They had people come up to be prayed for, and I was there. And he didn't know me from anyone. And he walked up to me, and he took both my hands, and he lifted it up, and he said, God's going to anoint your hands with the piano. And my first thought was, get thee behind the scene. He's a false prophet. However, when the man returned a year later, I was sitting at the piano, and I was playing in the church. I was using that gift for the Lord. It didn't matter that I couldn't read music. I still can't read music. These are chord sheets that just have words and chords. I mean, technically, I could sit down and do it, but I can't read and play. So if you think you're a turkey and you can't do anything, God can call you. Once you get into that place where the Lord wants you to be, He can do amazing things with you. I'm a 65-year-old woman. I should not be leading worship. And, you know, by man's standards, it's man's, when I first started, it was a man's thing to do. And it was funny, when I left that church and went to the next church, they discovered I could play keyboard. They go, well, that's interesting because we ordered one. We didn't have anyone to play it, but Faith, we ordered a keyboard, and God put me into that position. So He is way ahead of us. His steps are way farther ahead of us. He sees a whole different us than what we see. So look up. You're about to draw an eye. I mean, the Lord has a good plan for your life. It may be completely awkward and completely not what you planned and completely uncomfortable. But if you put that one foot in front of the other and are just faithful and you're willing to say, okay, this is you, and every service that I played after that time, before I would play, my hands would go up in the air and say, okay, you gave me a promise that you would anoint these hands to play. And so now I'm going to play. Thank you.
your children. We are just a part of your family. And we can't thank you enough for that opportunity. And Lord, we thank you for the new member of the Ross family this morning, for little Maverick, who was born to Trevor and Kelly. Lord, we ask that you bless mother and son alike. Undertake to provide good health for both of them through the days ahead. We rejoice in the progress Vivian is making. Lord, we continue to ask for your direction for doctors who will be seeing her, and we look to you for complete health for her. We pray for George, for his health, and for John, and Lord, for Andrea's brother. He's having his stitches finally removed so he can walk, and that's happening this week. Lord, we look to you to undertake that process and continue to bring healing and strength. For Sabrina Foster, Lord, you know that the challenge that she's having looking for a new home. And so, Lord, we ask that you would guide her and open up the hearts of someone who might not even know her, but know of a need. And Lord, just bring them together. That's what the power of your Spirit can accomplish. We just thank you for that process. This morning, we pray for, we thank you for Dennis Whelan's successful knee surgery, the fact that he's home. Lord, and just continue to bring strength and healing to him. You are the great physician, and we continue to look to you. You are our rock and our salvation, and it's in you that we put all of our trust. We ask you to bless the food that we'll receive as the meetings meet. They gather together, and we pray, Lord, for the meetings that will be happening following worship. Lord, may your Spirit be the guide and the director of the process of the business of your church. So we just rejoice in you. We thank you. We thank you for the prayer that you've given us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please stand for the benediction. Now, to him who is able to do more abundantly beyond all that we can ask, all beyond what we can even think, according to the power that works within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus, to all generations, forever and ever.